Morning, everybody. Welcome to this cabinet meeting. First item on the agenda, members' code of conduct, declaration of interest. Are there any declarations of interest from any cabinet members? Councillor Jones.
Thank you, Pat. Can I declare a personal interest in that I vote for Cheshire and Wirral partnership?
Thank you very much. Anybody else? No? Okay. Okay. Item number two, the minutes of the last meeting.
Exempt Cllr Liz Grey from council tax and any these that have been approved, I think have already been written off, but we will continue that policy. Another change is an increase on our rent and homes ex-property premium to 300% of council tax for any properties that have been empty for more than 5 years. We've got housing prices at the minute, and what we can't afford to have is landlords just sitting on empty properties which could be brought back into use. So this should, I hope, prompt those landlords to either bring the properties back into use or to pay us 307 council tax. And probably the initiative I'm most proud of today would be our local council tax reduction scheme, which we approved from April 2020. This means that 9,000 of the poorest households on the Wirral will see a reduction of up to half on their council taxes. So what we're doing through council tax is enabling our most vulnerable residents who will be paying less. As I say, council tax is unfortunately one of those areas whereby the government have passed on the savings or the cuts to local authorities, and we do rely very much on our money coming in. But these measures put in place here for the exemption on refuge, on care leavers, an increase in the empty property premium, and then 9,000 poorest households get a break on their council tax next year. It goes some way to mitigate that. So I ask my colleagues to accept the recommendations outlined on page 23.
Thank you. Thanks, Councillor Williamson. Any questions? Councillor Usher.
Just a couple of comments, really, Chair. Obviously, the past decade, local government have its resources stripped away from it. In the face of increasingly acute crises, such as the adult social care and children's social care crisis, the only solution that's been forthcoming from central government has been that we can tag on precepts to our council tax, which of course passes the burden onto the resident, and that has caused pressure in terms of household incomes. I think what this scheme does from the council is that it uses its powers progressively to ensure that we're doing what we can in times of hardship, to ensure that we're trying to set progressive council tax band, and that we're ensuring that we do something to relieve the pressure on struggling families. So I really welcome it, and I'm glad that the council Williamson pointed out a piece of national best practice which we've adopted as well, which is that we exempt care leavers from council tax, and hope that other councils across the land will take that piece up as well. Thanks.
Thanks,
Councillor
Chair. Any other questions?
Councillor Gray. Thank you. I think it's excellent. I think it should celebrate the fact that the administration is really looking at the most vulnerable. We've got serious difficult vulnerable groups here, and all being looked after, and all looking after the environment. But protecting our housing stock in the middle of a housing crisis, I think it's really significant.
Thank you. Any other questions? Can I just say, just briefly, I mean, this is this sums up what this administration is about. It's the hallmark of this administration, looking after those vulnerable, those in need, and those in poverty, and those on the bottom rung, and long may continue. And these policies put forward during a time of austerity is a great example of that. So thanks, Councillor Wilson, for that report. Okay, can I have somebody to formally move it? Yeah, and second it. Thank you. Can we agree? Thank you very much. Okay, go on to the next item on the agenda. Again, Councillor Williamson. Quarter 2 2019-20 revenue financial monitoring. Councillor Williamson.
Thanks, Pat. So this follows on from what I was saying in the previous report about how central government cuts are really biting within liberal authorities up and down the country. The position I report today, I imagine, will be similar across the country. So we're forecasting a labour spend of 7.1 million currently. This is mainly due to increased demand for services for vulnerable people, adults and children. Demand is sometimes about increased volumes of people requiring help. It's also about increased levels of complex care required by our residents, which cost us more. Living services, we're experiencing £30 million worth of demand pressures, but careful management of activity and funding is mitigating at least £5.8 million. A number of savings initiatives have not materialised this year, such as the change of the floral and golf, and they've contributed to the overspend. It's not a viable position, an overspend. A number of savings initiatives are underway to reduce the overspend, and this includes a spend freeze, recruitment freeze, and a series of dedicated actions addressing each area of the overspend. We're not alone in this. Other local authorities are experiencing similar problems. However, it is our collective responsibility to set and manage a legal budget. Members and officers are working together to address this, and Pat, this is the third year on the run. I, as Cabinet Member for Finance, have had to sit in front of my colleagues and say that we are being absolutely battered by this government and I'm sick to death of it. I'm sick of it, our residents don't deserve it, and we're doing everything that we humanly can to mitigate against. I do note with interest that this Conservative government have managed to locate that magic money tree during the time of general election and seems to be chucking millions and billions of all kinds. However, local authorities have to be funded on a sustainable footing. We need consistent funding from the government and a long-term plan. We are almost at the point where we're having to make decisions that we just don't want to make, and it's not good enough. So what I will put a play out there during the general election time is up your game, Conservatives, and look at local authorities and give us some money, because this is not a desirable position to be in. Having said that, the general election, I imagine, will yield us rewards that we want and change the government and hopefully change our situation. However, we will deliver a balanced budget. That is our obligation and that's what we will do. So I ask my colleagues to agree the recommendations there on page 32.
Okay, can we have a second there? Second. Second there, yeah. Thank you. Okay, item 7, Councillor Janette Williamson again, quarter 2, 2019-20, capital financial monitoring. Councillor Williamson.
Me again. So, this is about our capital programme, shows how we're investing in the long-term future for the whole borough and investments in businesses. So this report shows the changes to the programme, the most significant change being the rephasing of capital investment projects in regeneration. This is because of as opportunities arise, we're aligning our funding to best access these schemes, including rural waters, housing infrastructure and property purchases. We've also secured some new funding which is supporting capital programmes, such as alcohol treatment and for the transport feasibility study for highways. Again, as I invite my colleagues to agree the recommendations in the reports.
Okay, so any questions? No, as we formally agree, we have a seconder. Can you agree? Okay, that's amazing, Ken. Minimum revenue for a big week.
Not worth turning my off, is it? Okay, this is the revenue reports. MRP represents the payment of borrowing spread over the years and we're expected to repay. Council has options on how to profile future payments, and profiling allows the organisation to safety manage its revenue position. Our recommendation passes and Cabinet endorses the proposal to reprofile MRP changes, resulting in the reduction of MRP charges by 80 million per annum over the next 10 years.
Okay. Are you for me moving then?
So moved.
Yeah. Do we have a second then? Yeah. Do we agree? The last one, Treasury Manager Interim Report.
That's a big exercise, isn't it? Okay, so the Treasury Function manages the cost of borrowing and maximising the opportunity to make money from our cash investments whilst managing the financial risks. This report provides an update to the performance of these investments and on borrowing. Council is on the 1920 target to make savings of £2 million on these activities, which is particularly good news based on the charter environment we're operating in. This supports the wider organisation. organisation meets its financial commitments. The recommendation is that the report is agreed by my colleagues.
Okay, I'll second that. Yeah. Okay. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. Item 10, an application for financial assistance on pages 79 to 84 on the hard copy. Councillor Tony Jones.
Thanks, Pat. I'll speak to items 10 and 11 together, if that's okay. As an authority, I have an obligation to nurture, support and encourage businesses within the borough. A healthy local economy attracts investment, supports well-paid jobs and encourages additional growth, as well as creating opportunities for our young people. Take the 20 apprentices that have just started at Lourdes as an example. We need to invest in businesses within the region and within the authority. And it sends a clear, unambiguous signal that Wirral is open for business and we mean business. The fear of repeating itself, it supports and creates jobs, it increases investment, and it helps businesses thrive, which is what regeneration and growth is all about. Can I ask my cabinet colleagues to support the recommendation for both items 10 and 11? Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Jones, thank you very much. That's both reports, 10 and 11 together. Any comments on that, first of all? No? Can I have a mover and seconder for number 10?
So moved.
Seconder, can we agree with that?
Yes.
Thank you. Can I have a mover and seconder for number 11?
So moved.
Seconder, yeah, can we agree with that? Thank you. Okay, we now come to number 12. Agenda, which is the exempt item, the exclusion of the press and public. I just have to say the following. Under section 108(4) of the Local Government Act 1972, publicly excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the grounds that they involve the likely disclosure of exempt information as defined by Part 1 of Schedule 12A, as amended to the Act. Public interest test has been applied and favours exclusion. So thank you everyone. Thank you.